today is, rejoice that your name is written in heaven. Rejoice that your name is written in heaven. And you have heard the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verses 1 to 20. Let me ask you a question. Have you watched the news lately? Have you watched the news lately? What we have seen? Destruction all over, terrorists, many people being killed. Last week was in Turkey and also the other country, Asian people, Bangladesh. Almost every day we notice the number of people who have been killed. And the question that comes is, that is the question which comes up. How many people have died without Christ? Because of terrorism, because of illnesses, whatever circumstances. How many people have been dying without Christ, Jesus? That is something to open our eyes and let us be alert. And today I'm going to talk about personal evangelism, which is one of the most important tasks that the church, are in charge of. And this is the first message of a series of sermons on that topic about evangelism. Is that also part of our morning class, when we have been talking about that, but today we started up the topic of evangelism, and I insist with you to come to the morning class at 8:45 so that we may be engaged. In this gospel for today, Luke highlighted the universal mission of Jesus Christ. He highlighted that. And Jesus said, not only once, but many times, that the gospel would go to all people. The gospel would go to all people, people from all nations. And when we look around us, we find people from all nations, from all different ethnic groups, and also young people, older people, you find, you name it, what kind of people you find, and we are in charge to spread the gospel and to reach out to those people. What was Jesus' initiative to accomplish that purpose? Number one, he trained people. He did not send people without training them. This is one of the priorities over here. We are here to train people to get ready to spread the gospel and to share the good news with all people. And then, he trained and sent 70 people. 70 people at that very time. He sent on before he went to visit with different people in different towns around. He sent those people, and what was the strategy? Have two of them each time they would be visiting with people or some town, they would go, two of them together. And let me tell you, at the time when Jesus finished his ministry on earth, he had at least 500 people who were disciples of Jesus ready to go out and to spread the good news of the gospel. And among those, 120 people went to Jerusalem, which was the center of that world back then. He sent 120 people to plant the church over there. How many churches have been planted in America lately? How many churches are really involved in evangelism? And let us take a look, because we have not to reinvent the wheel. We have just to follow Jesus' instructions and do whatever he told us to do. So the first step is to train people. The second step is to get people ready to go. Ready to go. What is the next step? He went out looking for the needy people. Jesus went out along with his disciples. He did not send them on their own. The first step was to go along with them, and the second step was to let them go on their own to accomplish the mission. But when he went out along with his disciples, what he was looking for? He was looking for people in need. What kind of need? Was Jesus asking the ones who did not have a car to drive? Was Jesus asking the ones who did not have a house or a home? No, Jesus was looking for people who were hurting, either because of emotional illnesses, emotional problems, psychological problems, and also people who needed spiritual help. How many people follow Jesus Christ? How many people follow him? As you look at the Gospels, as you look at the, what is written in the Gospels, you find people with all kinds of illnesses. I preached about that last Sunday. And he healed them all. There's no illness, either emotional, psychological, or physical, that Jesus would not be taking care of the ones who are suffering. This is our goal nowadays. The church is in charge of going and looking for the people and be connected to the people who are in need. And that is the most important aspect of any church ministry. And what is remarkable over here? What is remarkable in this gospel? Jesus compared the work of evangelism with the harvest. That was a good comparison if we think about the harvest. What is necessary to be done before the harvest? Number one, in order to get a good harvest, we must choose the soil. The people who are planting seeds, the first step is to look at the soil to see what kind of soil they have. And then the second step is to prepare the soil for the seeds. And also what is essential is to water. Watering is essential and has to be done regularly, not just water the soil and let the soil be there, but checking out the soil daily to keep the moisture of the soil so that the seeds would germinate. That is the process of people who are dedicated to agriculture. In Nebraska, for instance, they know that very well. But my question is, who causes that to grow? Who causes the seeds to grow? Neither the ones who plant the seeds, nor the ones who water the seeds, but God himself. Pay attention to that. God is the one who lets the seeds grow, and then to have the rains, so that when it is time to ripen, everybody is going to be glad to see. But many of them, they do not pay attention that the one who leads the seeds to grow is God himself. The same as the church. When we talk about evangelism, we are in charge to do something which is our job, but the one who makes the seeds grow, the one who makes the church be mature is God Himself. We can't do that. We depend on the work of the Holy Spirit. And what is Jesus' strategy? Jesus wants to reach out to people from all nations, as it is written, and evangelize them so that they can be saved. As much people as we get close to Christ, as much people we lead them to come to Christ, that is our most important aspect of life. We all had someone who led us to Christ. Either our parents, our grandparents, our friends. So personal evangelism is the most effective way to get people to come to Christ. But what happens is that Jesus said, and she read this verse which says, the harvest is plentiful, but what? The workers are few. The workers are few. Is something different happening nowadays? The workers are few. So how can we solve our problem? How can we implement evangelism? Jesus gave the solution. What he said? Pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into the harvest. Wow, that is important. What we notice here, the first commandment is to pray to the Lord of the harvest in order to get workers involved, because he knew what would be going on all over the world, and it was never different. To evangelize is something that is not easy, but it is possible with God's help. And here we are. Let me tell you. Evangelism is part of our outreach effort. We were talking about that this morning, was the first lesson. Many people, they think that outreach and evangelism is the same thing. No. Outreach is the way that we use to reach out to people. But the evangelism is the next step. If we reach out to people, but we do not bring people to Christ, there's no evangelism. And that is the core of the message for today. If we want to see more people before they die, if we want to see more people coming to Christ, evangelism is something urgent to be implemented. And we are the church, we are in charge of that. Jesus passed that mission unto us. So, number one is to pray, asking the Lord to send volunteers. And I'll tell you, that happens. It happened to us when we were in California. We used to spend time in prayer, and the Lord sent people to be involved and willing to be busy with the harvest. And something very important. As far as Jesus said that we have to reach out to all the people, this is a community church. But the mission of the church is not limited to this neighborhood. We are supposed to reach out to people wherever they are. If God opens a door for us, as He had already opened the door to go to the Providence Rescue Mission, where we are going every month to serve people over there, this is another open door. We are not supposed to be limited to our neighborhood. And number two, we have to do something else. If each one of us, listen, if each one of us lists two or three people from our relationship, people who are our friends, people who are co-workers, people who are part of our family who did not come to Christ yet, people who are coming to the meeting on Fridays over here that you are in charge of, the most important thing is to evangelize them, is to let them know that God loves them. And if there is no repentance He does not do anything wrong in terms of applying and showing this law. So each and every one of the people, doesn't matter what they did wrong, they are elected or they qualify to receive Christ as their Lord and Savior. Even our enemies, that is what the Bible says. So if we list our friends, some of them, and start up praying for them, even before approaching them, we have to start praying for them. For our kids, grandkids, great-grandkids, whoever we know that we would like to see that person come into Christ. The first step is to be busy praying for them and asking the Lord to touch their hearts and let them know that what they need the most is God's love. In addition, we have talked about that already. The church is thinking, the leadership of the church is thinking about something new. To implement a kind of fellowship time, not as part of our Sunday program, but having a kind of fellowship time, gathering together with people. But one thing is for sure, we must be clear about that. The church tradition nowadays, not only our congregation, but the mainline churches, they think that we have to wait for people to come. Yes, they may come. There's nothing wrong with that. But Jesus never stayed there waiting for the people to come to the temple. He went after them to reach them out. This is our job in terms of evangelism. Whoever we know that is in need of God and in need of God's love, we are the ones who are going to go out, and the leaders of the church are going to follow them whenever we set up a conversation, either going to the coffee shop or whatever. We have to save time for that. Evangelism requires our time and our dedication so that when we build up relationships, the Lord is going to do what is His part. I'm really glad that last Thursday, when we had the food pantry open, I have been coming and telling them that we are available to them. Every Thursday when we have that kind of food distribution. But last Sunday got put in my heart. Now is the time to ask them something. And I asked each and every one of them, do you have any prayer requests? Listen, I did not preach to them. It is not time yet. But I asked them, do you have any prayer requests? I'll tell you, I should not be surprised. But I was surprised because each and every one of them, we did not have many this week, but each and every one of them, they had a prayer request, either for themselves, for their health, or for their families, or for their friends who were in need of prayer. Brothers and sisters, this is the long-term process. We have to build up relationships. If we would never come to listen to those people around the table, they would never have that kind of trust to ask us for prayer. So we went a step further. This is our job. How many of us would be happy to be here at that very day and just be there to listen to them and to talk with people? When we go to any place and we have prayed to the Lord asking Him to help us, I'll tell you, He is going to open the doors for you. He is going to show you people that you have never thought would be open to talk about God, or to talk about Jesus, or to talk about their struggles. He's the one who touches people's hearts. So this is the first step of our conversations in terms of evangelism. I'll keep talking about that. But what is the result of our efforts? What is written? if we go back to that gospel and we read verses 17 to 20, what is written over there? What is going to be the outcome of this kind of effort? The word says what happened long ago and is going to happen in the name of Jesus. So the Lord said, the 70 returned with joy, saying, Lord, in your name even the demons submit to us. And Jesus replied, I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning. See, I have given you authority. Jesus gives us authority to do that in his name. I have given you authority to tread on snakes and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing will hurt you. Nevertheless, Jesus said, do not rejoice at this. Do not rejoice at this, that the Spirit submits to you. And what is the reward that we are going to receive? Are we going to receive something extraordinary from the Lord? We may receive many, many blessings that we receive. We may prosper in terms of our spiritual life. But what is the main reward? What Jesus said on the second part of verse 20. Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the Spirit submits to you. But rejoice that your names are written where? Rejoice that your names are written in heaven. This is the title of the message. This is the promise from the Lord. So, how many people are dying with Christ without their names written in heaven? How many are dying without their names written? So that is a food for thought that I pass on to you during this week. Do not waste your time. What is going on all over the world? We have to be alert. We have to pay attention because it is written that such things would happen. So let us take the first step now, right now, praying to the Lord to help us to fulfill this new endeavor which will lead this church to grow, both spiritually and also numerically. Amen? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we desperately need your help. We need the help of your Holy Spirit, Lord. Let us understand the urgency of evangelism. Let us be your instruments to lead people to Christ so that whenever they die, they are going to die in Christ. And that's going to be a great privilege, Lord. So please guide us. Give us the courage to approach people, but do not let us do that thinking that we are able to convict people of their sins and their necessity of forgiveness and the necessity to receive God's love. We know, Lord, that we are all people because we all sin and we fall short of your glory. But your mercy, your love is always available to us. So teach us, Lord, and let us make progress. Let us use our lives for your glory as your instruments, instruments of Jesus' mission on earth. In Jesus' precious name we pray, and the people may respond.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
So, let us sing.